So now we'll discuss a little bit more about what you can calculate with your Green's functions and some variables that are necessary for your knowledge. So here, these slides will contain basically all of these variables. So your this E is an electrode index, your Hamiltonian, your overlap, that may be an identity matrix if your basis is an orthogonal basis, your density matrix, the self-energy. Again, this need not to be an electrode, it could be some other kind of self-energy. Your scattering matrix from a from an electrode, and a Green's function, a spectral function, and this is the spectral density of states that originates from a given electrode. So this has an electrode index as well. We have a transmission function going from one electrode to another electrode, and then we also have a total transmission out of an electrode. So here the basic equations are like this, G, your Green's function, and that is your overlap minus H, and then your self-energy terms, just like we had it previously. The scattering matrix from your electrodes E becomes this term, that's your self-energy minus the Dagger version of itself. And then your spectral density of states originating from a single electrode is your Green's functions, your Green's function multiplied by your scattering matrix and your Green's function Dagger. And from these ones, you can calculate quite a bit of physical properties. So here, the density of states can be separated into a bunch of various ways. So here above, in the top panel, you have the total density of states. That's your trace of your density matrix times S. That may also be expressed in your Green's function formalism via this term here. And here you'll note that there's a direct link between your Green's function and your density matrix. You can actually calculate your density matrix from your Green's function. And that's basically what SIESTA does, but what TP-Trans does is calculating your density of states like this. Then you have your spectral density of states, which is your density originating from a specific electrode. And there you can sort of figure out how a specific part of your device region couples to a specific electrode. And that may be quite interesting for certain properties. Another way to describe your density of states is by summing up all your spectral density of states. So that's this one. So by summing over this for all your electrode indices, you'll also get your density of states. But you also have this bound states. So one way to figure out if you have a bound state is by calculating this one and checking whether they are both equal. The difference between the two will give you where your bound states live. So it's very trivial to figure out if you have bound states by doing this calculation. Now, you can only do this in TP-Trans, but that's typically also fine. You do a SIESTA calculation, you do a TP-Trans, figure out if you have bound states. And if you want to do something additional to your bound states, like adding an eta value to broaden that state, you can do so. Then you also have the local density of states on a specific orbital, in this case V, and that's just by taking the subparts of your matrix elements here. So your traces instead of that, or your matrix multiplications, and then take your diagonal part. And that's what you can do in SISL. It will allow you to extract that information from TP-Trans output file, such that you can analyze it quite fast. And the same thing goes down here. You still have this relationship down here, so you can figure out on exactly which orbitals you have your bound states and try to do your analysis by looking at a specific orbital and at a specific energy. So that's very informative to look at it like this. So the overlap matrix is of course extremely important when calculating the density of states, because you have your Green's function times your S. And if you have a non-orthogonal basis, that means that you should typically have a little bit larger. I mean, there's a region at the border of where you calculate your Green's function, where you cannot really trust that your density of states is correct, because you have an overlap that extends outside of your Green's function region or your device region. We will come back to this later. Again, your eta value is what broadens your density of states, similar to a large eta value. And that's only for states that couples to the electrodes. So if your eta value in your self-energy calculations were quite big, that also translates into a broadening of your states in your device region calculation, because of the way that the self-energy is propagated into your device region. So if you want to have a very good resolved state in your density of state, or some kind of peak that you're very much interested in, you need to use a very, very small eta value. And most probably you also don't want to use an eta value in your device region if you can go without it. But in terms of bound states, if you have bound states, you should use an eta value in your device region as well. Then there are the transmissions, and there are three calculations here. You can calculate your transmission between any two electrodes like this, and you'll note that this term out here, G, gamma G, that's your spectral matrix. And you should think of this, I think of this like your spectral density of states, that's your matrix A. That is what is propagating your electrons from a specific electrode into your device region. And then your second gamma, or your second scattering matrix, is what captures the electrons that originate from one electrode. And you can sort of see how much of that electron leaves the other electrode via this term. So that's how you should think of it in that terms. The total transmission out of your electrode is just the summation of all the combinations of your electrode to another electrode. And that's quite trivial. You cannot lose an electron. So you really have to have unity here. It's obeying Kirchhoff's laws and particle conservation. So you will not lose an electron. Otherwise, something went wrong in the calculation. And that's also why you can calculate the reflection. So the reflection is just one minus your total transmission out of your electrode. And here one is meaning your bulk transmission. So that's your open channels. And TB-trans can also calculate your bulk transmission. So it's quite trivial to figure out how many open channels you have in a specific electrode, for instance. This is a little bit more elaborate, this calculation, but it's not too difficult. Let me note a small numerical problem for this one. If you have a very, very large electrode, meaning you have, say, 100 open channels or something like this, this one can be a little bit numerically unstable, simply because of the large numeric values you're calculating. But for small electrodes, this is not a problem. I've just experienced that for very, very big electrodes, the accuracy of this may be a little bit problematic. There are also symmetries. You have time reversal symmetry. That's for polarized and non-polarized system. That this doesn't hold for a spin orbit, for instance. But for regular polarized calculations, you have this relationship here. Any transmission that goes out of an electrode into another electrode equals what goes out of that electrode into another electrode. You have equal transmission probability between two electrodes. And then on top of this, with time reversal symmetry, you also do this for your minus K. Yeah. Then there are what is called orbital or bond currents, and they give you an idea of how your electrons move about in your scattering region. So you can determine how an electron jumps between two sites by using your spectral function times your Hamiltonian indices. And again, so TVTrans does this for you, and Sizzle allows you to post-process this. I'll note that the quantities calculated in TVTrans are without the prefactor E over H. So you can just add that if you want. So in reality, they are bond transmissions and not really bond currents, but it's a prefactor, and that should be quite true to add. Again, bond currents obey Kirchhoff's laws. So you can encircle any kind of region in your device region, and you'll have current conservation. What goes in must come out. So if you have a perfect circle inside of your system, if you sum what goes in and out on your circle, you should get zero, because everything that goes in must come out. That also means that you can split your device region in any way you want and still get the correct transmission. So if you cut your device region along one line, what goes across that line equals the transmission between those two electrodes, and you can draw that line in another way, and you will still get the same result. That's always fun to try. It's a little bit difficult, but you can play around with this. The problem of the bond currents is that they are not time reversal symmetry, because you have a momentum of your electrons. And that means that you cannot just expect the bond currents for a specific k to be the same as for the negative k. And that has to do with the slope of the electrons. They have a specific velocity, and you have to take that into consideration. You cannot just do a k average bond current using time reversal symmetry. This will give you wrong results. So here's an example of this. This is just a square lattice. We have periodicity along the x direction down here, and transport along the y direction, that's up. And I have exactly the same k-point sampling. One of them is just using time reversal symmetry, that's the left, and the right one is using the entire Brin zone. And as you can see in the left picture, you have a tendency to tilt right. And that's because you don't get the other momentum part of your electrodes or your electrons on the other side of the Brin zone. So if you're going to do this, TVTrans will give you a warning if you don't remove time reversal symmetry when you calculate bond currents. But it's just a warning. You can still do it. So it's your responsibility to examine the output correctly and be sure that you are not using the data incorrectly. In some cases, it may be interesting just to see how the bond currents looks at a specific K, and therefore it's enabled like this. Okay, and this is just an overview slide where these are the quantities you can calculate, and all of these are depending on the Brin zone integration. So you have this K dependency of all these quantities, and you need a pretty high K point sampling in order to get these in the correct resolved physical, to get a correctly physical interpretation of these quantities. So this relates to your band structure. If you are going to do a band structure, you need very fine K point meshes to figure out the exact contribution for a specific K and a specific energy. And the same thing goes for TVTrans. You need a lot higher K point sampling to be able to do a perfect or a good energy resolve physical quantities. If you want to know what the density of states, for instance, is, you really need to have a high K point sampling. Yeah. I think that's also 15 minutes. Yeah, so I'll just take 5 minutes break.
And then maybe you can have a look at the questions.
Sorry?
Maybe you could take a look at the questions.
Ah, yeah, before we move on. Yeah. So Constantine asks, how reliable are the default values of your electrode eta values of 1 millielectron? May I simply keep this value and set accordingly K mesh and E spacing? I would say that the 1 millielectron is pretty decent if you're for basically all calculations, I would say. This is not to say that you should silently trust everything that are default values. They are there because you can tune them for your needs. If you have a very, very low temperature, electronic temperature, then you should probably also play with your eta value to be a little bit smaller. Your electronic temperature spreads out your energy close to your Fermi level, and this one just spreads all of your energy values at all energies. So you have to, it has a physical meaning of spreading your states like this. So you don't want to be very high. If this eta value goes, say, to 1 eV, what you'll simulate is just a flat band or a flat density of states landscape. So if you're going to simulate some kind of system that connects to a wide band approximation, then it may be fine for you to just blow up your eta value and see how that performs. We've done that in a previous study where you can see how an electrode behaves if it were a wideband approximation. But I would say generally 1 MeV is pretty good. Samuel Ponce asks, what physical quantities can you extract from the off-diagonal orbital index, spectral functions, density of states, etc. Can you compute transistor? So you can, in transistor, it doesn't really output that, but in TP-trans, it writes out your off-diagonal components of your spectral functions and your Green's functions. And they are related to your density matrices. So if you save your, and that you can also, you can ask TP-trans to calculate your density matrix for a specific energy or something like that. And you can then use your density matrix at a specific energy to calculate your local real space density of states. So you can also do that in CISL. You can post-process your density matrix and plot that in real space to see how it looks. So that could be, for instance, used in STM pictures or something like that. You can calculate it for a certain range of energies, use your own broadening mechanisms or stuff like that. So the off diagonals are still important for density matrices. I hope that answered the question. Alessandra asks, with your formalism, you can calculate transmission in for each K point of reciprocal space, or the entire calculation needs to be done in real space? No, so TP-trans does the transmission calculations for each K point in the Brillouin zone that you define. And afterwards, you can post-process each of these K points individually. So you can plot your transmissions at a specific energy in your Brillouin zone and create a 2D contour map of your Brillouin zone. If it's a 2D, well, if your system is 3D, if your system is 2D, then you can do a 1D Brillouin zone plot for specific energy, or do a 2D energy versus K resolution.